right, guys, thanks for coming on. Why don't we start by introducing yourselves and a little bit about your background and what you're here for in the CNMI's first trip here.
Sure. I'm Rick MacPherson. I'm a coral reef ecologist. I've been working in coral reef conservation and coral reef science for going on 30 years now.
And I'm Andrew Thaler. I'm a deep sea ecologist, and I've been working on deep sea ecology and conservation of deep sea ecosystems, particularly those around deep sea hydrothermal vents as well as deep trenches.
And we've been spending time this week here on Saipan, and this is our first time on the island. And our interest is to share some of the most current science that's taking place in the waters in and around the Marianas Trench.
And what is the most current science? Let's start with the thermal vents. That sounds interesting. We're in the Pacific Ring of Fire. Explain what that is, and explain maybe what the trench is and what's happening there. It's a moving piece of equipment, for lack of a better word.
Certainly. So the Marianas Trench is the deepest trench in the world, at about 11,000 meters. So if you took Mount Everest, poured it into the trench, you'd still have about a mile of water on top of it. And it's formed because we've got two big oceanic tectonic plates that are colliding. One of them is subducting under the other. And so in addition to getting this very, very deep chasm that goes down, you also get a ton of fascinating geologic phenomena that happened around it. And one of those phenomena is the hydrothermal vents, which are essentially underwater geysers. They work a little bit differently in that you have seawater that percolates down into the crust of the earth, and then it hits magma, gets very, very hot, shoots back out through a series of pipes in the seafloor called stockworks. And when it contacts cold seawater, it turns into this chemical and nutrient-rich plume that sort of bubbles out from what looks like a chimney on the seafloor. So when you go down, it really looks like someone has a coal furnace burning at the bottom of the sea. There's this huge, gorgeous black plume that kind of bubbles out in this big cloud. And the water that comes out of the vent is very, very hot. As soon as you get a few millimeters away, it goes back to background sea temperature, about 4 degrees Celsius. Around these vent systems, you have animals that can exploit this incredible chemical energy coming out of the vents. And they do it in a way that is not common on the planet. So a lot of times we think about life on Earth. We think about photosynthesis, so taking energy from the sun. And up until about the 1970s, we thought that pretty much all life on Earth needed energy from the sun to really get going. Then we discovered hydrothermal vents. We discovered them in the East Pacific, and then a few years later started finding them in the South and West Pacific and all over the world. And these animals don't need sunlight. They have special bacteria that live inside of them that can take chemical energy directly out of the vents and turn it into food for the animals. And this very interesting partnership between animal and bacteria and archaea, which are microorganisms that are much like bacteria.
So we hear that we know less about what's happening at the bottom of the trench than we know about the moon. Is that still the case, and is it changing?
That is definitely the case. So in the last 80 years, we've had 4 vehicles that have been able to dive to the bottom of the Mariana Trench. There's the Trieste, which was a bathyscaphe in the 1960s. It functions almost like an underwater hot air balloon. So it's this giant container of jet fuel that gives it buoyancy, and then they just loaded it down with tons and tons and tons of steel weight and a tiny sphere at the bottom that 2 people kind of crammed inside and sat in for 8 hours, and it sinks to the bottom of the seafloor, and then you release the weights and it floats back up. That was the first time we'd gone down to the bottom of the Mariana Trench, and they spent maybe an hour on the bottom. Since then, the Japanese built a robot called the Kaiko, which dove to the bottom of the Marianas Trench several times. The U.S. built a robot called Nereus, which made a few dives. And then most recently, of course, James Cameron went down in his submarine, the Deep Sea Challenger, and spent maybe an hour on the seafloor. So all told, we've maybe spent 10 or 15 hours observing the bottom of the Marianas Trench. And the punchline is none of those vehicles are currently functional. So the Trieste was retired years and years and years ago. No one wants to dive to the bottom of the ocean in a 70-year-old vehicle. The Kaiko was lost at sea in a typhoon. The Nereus actually exploded while diving in the trench, so it's still down there somewhere. And James Cameron's submarine, unfortunately and anticlimactically, was damaged in a truck fire and has yet to be repaired. So right now we don't have any vehicles capable of going to the bottom of the Marianas Trench, which means that at the moment, we have more vehicles that have left our solar system than we have that are capable of exploring the Marianas Trench. So a full 7,000 meters of depth, more than half of the trench is currently out of our reach in terms of research. So there are uncountable numbers of unknowns that we have yet to explore down there.
Was Cameron's mission, is that bringing science to us, or was it a totally different reason that he went down there?
No, it was definitely a scientific expedition. Cameron is obviously a film director, a very enthusiastic deep sea explorer. He really does work very closely with scientists. I have several colleagues that were out on that cruise with him. He brought back data, he brought back samples. There are papers that have been coming out of those dives and out of the research he did during his test dives on the New Britain Trench. So it definitely was not just a publicity thing, it was a real scientific expedition that yielded some real and important discoveries.
But I do think it's worth pointing out that while he did conduct some science, I think what James Cameron also did was create some inspiration and some imagination and sparking interest in hopefully a whole new generation of ocean explorers or people that do want to know more about a part of the planet, an extreme part of the planet, the deepest point of the planet, where we know so little, exactly what Andrew was talking about. And I find it fascinating that he mentions James Cameron because James Cameron has been a source for how we've tried to imagine what life on other planets might look like. Probably the most popular movie, I believe, ever created, Avatar, depicted a world that on one level seemed so foreign and so strange, yet a lot of the imagery that James Cameron used to create the world of Pandora that we saw in Avatar was based on forms of life that are found within waters right here around Saipan, whether it was coral reef life like the trees that were depicted in the movie that looked like spirals that when the actor was touching during one scene of the movie and they sunk down into the earth. Those are basically identical to Christmas tree worms that you could find if I could paddle out to one of the reefs with you this afternoon and show you some of those worms that live attached to coral. It just goes to show you that some of the reality that we have here that has either been discovered or is as yet undiscovered could challenge the most bizarre fantasies we have of what life could look like on another planet.
Right. Now you focus more closer to the surface on the things that you study.
I do.
Tell me a little bit about what you have learned or what interests you that you see in these waters.
For the most part, my work doesn't involve the use of some of the technology that that Andrew gets to play with. He has some amazing toys that allow him to explore and expand the reach of our understanding for some of the deepest places on the planet. I have the fortune of working mostly in zones that are well lit, fairly close to shore. So I've been looking at coral reefs for the bulk of my career. Coral reefs. We're fortunate enough here in Saipan to be surrounded by coral reefs around the entirety of the island. They are ancient ecosystems. They're incredibly speciose or biodiverse ecosystems. It's been estimated that 25% of the life in our oceans is found concentrated within coral reefs. We often use rainforests as the metric by saying how diverse or biodiverse an environment is, and people have called coral reefs the rainforests of the sea. I would argue that we have that backwards. I think rainforests are the coral reefs of the land. You could walk a mile in a rainforest and see 1,000 different species of beetles, but they're all basically beetles. They're all arthropods. Whereas in 1 square foot of coral reef, you might find every phylum of life on our planet, every major grouping of life on our planet in that 1 square foot. So it's concentrated life, it's packed with life, and they form the backbone of a lot of island economies, their food security, basis of tourism. We love these nice white sandy beaches that we have here, and all of that sand is there because of the coral reefs that are just off of our shore. So I've been looking at the decline, unfortunately, of coral reefs over over my lifetime trying to find out, rather than just documenting the decline as a scientist, are there ways that I can try to avert that decline or change the trajectory of that decline? Part of that is to continue conducting science, because science helps informs the decisions that we're making. So I've been working with researchers throughout the Pacific, not here on Saipan, but in some of your neighboring islands, looking at things such as the presence or absence of sharks on coral reefs. And some of the most recent science that we're looking at, for example, some science that's been done just over the last 5 years, indicates that if you still have sharks and other predators like grouper or snapper on your coral reefs, the likelihood is that your reefs are doing much better than those reefs, those other reefs that the fish have been fished out. The sharks have been fished out, the groupers have been fished out, or the snapper have been fished out. And we're finding, it's a little bit complex, but we're finding a very interesting relationship between the presence or absence of sharks and whether coral reefs are thriving or are they tipping more towards seaweed or damage or disease-based. So that's some very interesting science that is taking place on island systems just like this. It just indicates there's still so much for us to understand. And the opportunities that the Marianas Trench and the waters surrounding the Northern Mariana Islands, it's just a fantastic opportunity for the scientific community to get excited and have a living laboratory that we can still explore in.
The reason that you're here is there is a push for a Mariana Trench sanctuary. Explain to me what the goal is and what the science behind it, what that means for people that live here.
Sure. So the Marianas Trench currently has protection as the Marianas Trench Marine National Monument. This was declared by George W. Bush before he left office. He created that monument, which protects the seafloor of the Marianas Trench itself and protects the island units, the seafloor around the island units themselves. It is an important first step for protection for the such a sensitive habitat, because it immediately restricts the possibility of seafloor mining coming in and potentially damaging some of those ecosystems that Andrew was talking about.
When you say seafloor mining, does that mean oil exploration, or what does that mean to what does that mean?
So the process that builds a hydrothermal vent is the same process that builds a mineral-rich ore body. And so sometimes you will find hydrothermal vent systems that are rich in heavy metals, that are rich in rare earth elements. And so when we talk about seafloor mining, we're actually talking about strip mining these hydrothermal vent ecosystems to extract the ore from them and turn them into precious metals and then dump the tailings somewhere on the seafloor.
And where is that happening? Is that a common?
It is an emerging industry. It has not taken place anywhere in the world yet. The International Seabed Authority regulates deep sea mining on the high seas and has begun issuing exploration lease permits, which give companies the ability to go and determine if there are ore bodies out there worth mining. There are some national mining authorities that have begun issuing exploitation permits, which then give companies the ability to go and actually extract the ore. And the only place that that is imminently happening is in Papua New Guinea. But at the moment, the progress of deep sea mining is limited by the technology and the expense of getting down to the seafloor. So it's one of those things that it's an emerging industry. It is going to be something that we will have to be dealt with in the next 10 years. But it's something that is only now beginning to take shape.
What are the other protections that the first step, the Bush legislation helps with?
Basically, it's a first step because it prioritizes this area as a sensitive area and worthy of protection based on either scientific merit, cultural merit, or historic merit. And those typically are the criteria that are looked at for a national monument. Currently, there is interest from the governor and others here in the NMI to look at adding another layer of protection through a National Marine Sanctuary protection. What the National Marine Sanctuary is as a designation brings in a prioritization for further research as well as for education, for interpretation. And with that come funding opportunities to expand that, not just saying that research and education are important, but backing that up with important opportunities for funding. So that is something that both Andrew and myself are interested in helping to support by helping to bring that some of that education, demonstrate the forms of education, outreach, and interpretation that can take place should a National Marine Sanctuary designation be brought, because it then creates an incentive for busy scientists who have research priorities or have teaching responsibilities to be able to see that there's an incentive for them to come here, conduct their research in the waters, as well as bring the research to the people and interpret it to the people. And that is everything from what we're doing this week in talking to people to things such as what Andrew does with his robotic technology and his hands-on citizen science work.
Yeah. How do people that are here, that live in the islands, how would they benefit? What are the direct benefits to? Is it education? Is it, what is it?
Do you want to talk a little bit about some of the opportunities that come from, you know, from Open ROV and the technology that you were?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, so one of the things we're trying to do is take a lot of the science that happens in the trench and translate it into a form that people can really learn how that science is, not just the results of the science, but how it's actually conducted. So one of the things that I work very hard on, and one of my major commitments, is to train students, high school students, to become robotic technicians. So I come out and I run workshops where high school students, usually juniors and seniors, sometimes younger. The youngest we've done is middle school. We've done 12 and 13-year-olds. And we teach them how to build underwater robots. And not just toys and not just little kits, but actual serious scientific instruments. And they're not as big as the multi-million dollar systems that we send down into the Marianas Trench, but they are essentially cognates of what we would send down those. So it's a smaller robot. It dives to 100 meters, but it carries the same kinds of payloads. It brings back the same kinds of data. You can do similar kinds of scientific experiments, the same kinds of scientific surveys that you would do with the big robots, but you do it in miniature. And so we go out and we train students not just to use these robots, but also to be able to service them and maintain them and introduce them to the idea that robotics, electronics, software programming, being a robotics technician, and being a marine biologist are possible career paths that can be open to them.
There's guys who go up there every couple years always have some different comments about what they see or what they don't see. Spending time in the trench, what sort of things are you seeing up there? Anything that surprised you? Anything that didn't surprise you?
So the thing, and this is not just unique to the trench, but this is true across the deep sea floor, but the thing that always shocks me whenever I go on deep sea expeditions, and just to be clear, I've never actually dove in the trench, but I have done trench work in similar systems around the world, is garbage. So everywhere we go in the world, we find trash. We'll find cans of Spam. We'll find Budweiser cans. We'll find plastic bags. And they're in places that we've never been before. You will go down to the seafloor at 5,000 meters deep, so 5 kilometers down, 2.5 miles, to a chunk of the ocean that no human has ever been before, and probably because of how limited our technology and access is, where no human will ever be again, and we'll find garbage. And it will already be there, and it will have been there for 30 years. So there really is this profound connection between, you know, the bottom of the Marianas Trench is the most remote place on the planet that anyone's ever been. It's so very far away from anything we ever think about in our day-to-day lives. It's completely out of sight, out of mind. People may think that the actions they take on the surface, drinking a can of beer and tossing it over the side of the boat, couldn't possibly affect the very bottom of the deepest trench in the world. But then there it is. All the trash is right down there. So, you know, that always shocks me the most, that our garbage precedes us really everywhere we go.
What scientifically, what sort of, every time we do these deep explorations, I'm guessing that we're finding new species, we're finding new things or new ways of doing things. You talked a little bit about people or organisms that could feed off energy that we didn't even know about a number of years ago.
So every time you go down to the deep sea, almost every time, you find new species. There have been two research cruises out to the Marianas Trench in the Northern Mariana Islands in the last 6 months. One was by the NOAA Office of Ocean Exploration and Research. They went out on the Okeanos Explorer. One was at the Schmidt Oceanographic Institute that went out in the RV Falkor. And they're actually out there right now. And they're sending back HD videos now. They're sending back pictures. And they're finding new species on just about every dive. In all likelihood, probably 90% of all species that are alive on Earth today have not been discovered by science. So, you know, we talked a little bit about resources in the deep sea, about deep sea mining, but the real resource in the Marianas Trench is the insight we can gain from studying it, the kinds of knowledge that can be found when you explore new and extreme environments that are very, very difficult for life to survive in, and yet somehow life continues to thrive down there. So the example I always like to give is, in the last 10 years, you know, we talk a lot about the human microbiome. So in medicine, we talk about how to build a healthy human. And the old paradigm is that a human is just us. It's our body. It's our DNA. But in reality, and what we've been discovering over the last decade, is that a human is more than just the sum of our own body and our own DNA. It's also a product of all the microorganisms that live inside of us, that help us digest, that help regulate body functions, that help break down skin cells and hair cells and process bacteria that live in our follicles and in our pores. And so really, when we think about a healthy human, we're thinking about a community of many, many, many organisms working together to make us a functional person. And we didn't really understand that until we discovered hydrothermal vents and saw these communities living in such close partnerships with bacteria living inside of them. So that kind of insight you can't put a dollar value on, but it's fundamentally changed the way we approach healthcare and medicine in the last 10 years.
Anything you guys want to add?
No, I want to come back. And, you know, this is just... This has been our first visit, and we have heard overwhelming interest from everyone that we've been meeting to hear more about what we're seeing and what we're learning. So this could just be the beginning for bringing this kind of outreach and education and awareness to the people here of the CNMI.
Yeah. And there are generations more work to be done in the Marianas Trench exploring it. There's 60, 70, 80, 100 years more work left to explore it, and there's so many more things left to discover. Half of it's not even within our reach right now.
All right, thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you. Angelo, welcome back.
Hey, what's up, man? Good to see you.
How are you?
It's been a while.
Yeah, how's the East Coast?
Well, the food's great, as you can probably tell.
You were involved in the monument from the get-go.
Yeah, it's been almost 10 years. It'll be 10 years next month.
I think you took Outside Magazine up there 9 years ago.
Yeah, we went up to Mog and Asuncion and Urracus, and we rounded the whole Mariana chain, and we actually fished all the way up there, and then stopped fishing when we got in the monument, did a couple dives, and then fished all the way back.
Now, 8 years ago, it's been two administrations ago when President Bush was on his way out, and he declared the monument, and now you're here hoping that it goes another step forward and becomes a sanctuary.
So what's going on? You know, if you could just kind of, you know, jump in a time machine and go back to 2008, you know, Lady Gaga is playing on the radio.
Not my radio.
You're more of a Bon Jovi guy. And, you know, me and, you know, other folks, we were advocating for a very large, highly protected, marine protected area that we hoped would be managed by the Office of NOAA Sanctuaries. On the January 9th, 2009, when it was actually declared, we got something that was a little bit smaller. Some of the protections were not as strong as we had hoped they would be, and management authority was given to the Department of Interior, and then ultimately the National Wildlife Refuge System. So a lot of the stuff that we were talking about, you know, the visitor center, a lot of the jobs, the assumptions that we were working under was that it would be as a sanctuary, managed by the sanctuary program, but it was given to a different government agency, which has a very different mission. So over the course of 8 years, there has been some movement. They have drafted, there is a draft management plan. It hasn't been released to the public, but they tell us that next year the public will have the opportunity to comment on this draft management plan for the monument. The submerged lands issue, that was a big deal about 8 years ago. The submerged lands issue is done, completely taken care of. Khalili introduced legislation. It passed in the House. This is the U.S. Congress. Passed in the House. It passed in the Senate. And it was signed by President Obama. They conveyed the submerged lands for 9 of the islands. And then just in December, this month, Governor Torres and Secretary of the Interior Sally Jewell signed a document that conveyed the submerged lands around the 3 northernmost islands. So that issue has completely been taken care of. But the pace at which this has happened has been quite slow. The original proclamation said that the management plan had to be done within 2 years. It's been almost 8, and it's still not finished. There's a lot of frustration with that. And when that management plan comes out, that's going to be a very good thing, and we'll applaud that and say, you know, we can get on with the management of the monument. But you also have to consider who is the manager and what is the mission of that manager. And the U.S. Fish and Wildlife, you know, they do great stuff. They protect a lot of America's resources. But their mission is slightly different from that of the sanctuary, which is what we initially wanted. They're more about a lot of enforcement, and the person. And they've actually hired this person. Their sort of job is they're going to have a badge and a gun, and their job is to enforcement. You know, keep the poachers, the foreign vessels outside of our waters.
Is that a big problem? Is that a big
no? Not
is
really.
That a major issue up there?
No, not at all. You can actually there are websites that'll show you where fishing boats are, and if you go to them, you'll see that there's actually very few fishing vessels, illegal or not, inside the EEZ or the U.S. EEZ around the Marianas. And that has to do with the fact that...
Where the fish are.
Well, the fish are, yeah. So the fish are more south. They're down in PNG or the southern half of FSM. But if, like, say you're if you're the captain of a legal fishing vessel and you want to go fish illegally somewhere, are you going to come to the United States EEZ that has the Navy and a Coast Guard? Or are you going to go down to, like, the Solomon Islands and, you know, Kiribati, where there's very limited enforcement. So we do get the occasional illegal fishing vessel in our waters, and the Coast Guard can attest to that. They will catch vessels now and then. But for the most part, there really isn't much fishing going on, much commercial, industrial-scale fishing going on in our waters.
So what would the sanctuary designation mean?
Yeah, so it's slightly different. So the mission of the sanctuary program is different from that in Fish and Wildlife. It's more about education and research and interpretation. And if President Obama were to move forward by beginning a sanctuary process, this community would go through a 3-year process where there would be scoping meetings and public hearings and time for public comment, wherein they would discuss what they wanted their sanctuary to be. And the mission is different. It's more about research and education. So those things like the visitor center that everybody wanted, it's the sanctuary program that does that, not the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. So if we want this visitor center, we will never get it with U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. The only way to get that is with the sanctuary program.
Is there a model out there that you look at and say, hey, we'd like it to
yes,
be like this?
Yes, absolutely. There's actually 2 going on right now. One is the Papahanaumokuakea Marine National Monument in Hawaii. And there's a number of managers that manage the different parts of that. The sanctuary program is involved. U.S. Fish and Wildlife is involved. NOAA Fisheries is involved. And even the state is involved. And there's also a similar model in American Samoa with the National Marine Sanctuary of American Samoa. And in fact, the monument could have been written like the sanctuary in American Samoa, and I wasn't involved in the government-to-government discussions. I've never worked for the government. I work for a nonprofit. All I can do is advocate for certain things. But whoever was advising the governor of American Samoa gave him some good advice. And he was able to bring the sanctuary program to his shores, whereas we did not get the sanctuary program. But if this process does begin, and President Obama decides to begin the sanctuary process, the sanctuary program would come out here, and they would be able to begin some of these outreach and educational programs. And we're really hoping that there would be these visitor educational centers. And you know, nobody expects to have the Monterey Bay Aquarium on the first day. The underwater world of Guam, you've been there, right? Mm. So their touch tank recently flooded, and they had to get rid of it, and they're trying to figure out what to replace that big room upstairs. And using private money, they're creating a Mariana's Trench exhibit. And they have a command center with videos from the trench. And we've actually been talking to them about being able to just replicate that and bring it to Saipan and Tinian and Rota. And you have your command center. We also visited the Smithsonian a couple weeks ago with Ike Cabrera and Paul Manglonia. And we looked at some of the things, some of the types of exhibits we could bring here that basically just, you know, copy it, make something similar and bring it here, throw in a couple picnic tables, and you've got yourself an educational center.
What do you think the chances are of this happening?
I'd say it's pretty good. The White House told us that we was me and Ike and Paul, gave a very strong argument for beginning the sanctuary process. So it was started by the governor and the delegate. They wrote to the president. The legislature has since jumped on board. The mayor of Tinian, the mayor of Rota, the mayor of the Northern Islands, they've been briefed and they're on board with bringing this. And I think what's going on is a lot of the controversy from the monument from 8 years ago has kind of settled down. That was a very contentious time in the CNMI, right? You know, our economy was just starting to tank. A lot of folks were leaving the island, and we were also dealing with federalization. I think now the monument is there, and people want to see the benefits start accruing. And by going through the sanctuary process, we'll see a lot more benefits, especially in terms of research and education.
All right. Thanks.
Awesome, man. Thanks
a lot. Appreciate it.